News recently broke about a new and perhaps shocking way that Pokemon is planning on combating both scalpers as well as meeting the overwhelming demand that they've seen for trading card products since 2020. Now, this new made-to-order or print-to-order system will come with many benefits, including a direct and simple way of combating a variety of different scalpers. However, it doesn't solve every single quote-unquote problem in the Pokemon TCG community, and in today's video, we're going to break that down. But, as always, before we get started, let's roll that intro. Hey, Gengar gang, what is going on? My name is Ryan, this is the Analytic Gengar, and welcome to another video. In today's video, friends, we talk about the 25th anniversary Golden Box from Japan and news that recently broke about the way that Pokemon Japan is planning on addressing the overwhelming demand for this product. Now, before we get started, as always, if you enjoyed today's video, make sure to leave a like on the channel, and hey, if you're not already, you're already halfway there, might as well go ahead and hit that big old subscribe button to join the Gengar gang. But without further ado, friends, let's go ahead and get on into this. So, the 25th anniversary over in Japan is going, as is our English equivalent, and one of the things that they are releasing is the 25th anniversary Golden Box. Now, you can basically say this is tantamount to our Ultra Premium Collection, both in terms of product offering as well as overall rarity. However, one of the things that is uniquely different about this box is that it prominently features Pikachu, and as you can see, there are a little bit of stylistic differences as well. So, one of the questions that has been asked over this is, how do you beat scalpers? Because as soon as this thing went up for pre-order, unsurprisingly, it went ahead and jammed up, meaning these things popped up all over the internet. They were crazy, crazy expensive for pre-order. And mind you, this is even before the product officially launched on store shelves. So, as a result, Pokemon Japan was faced with an interesting conundrum. Either they allow things to continue happening the way they are, or they attempt to implement some sort of strategy in order to control the rampant amount of scalping that will happen. Similar to the way it happens here in the US, whenever this stuff goes up for pre-order online, bots and scalpers usually get to this stuff first, they usually buy up all the inventory, and then they are able to go on eBay or another third-party marketplace, list this stuff up, oftentimes for double, if not triple, if not multiple times the MSRP on the box. So, the way that Pokemon went about addressing that, at least in some limited capacity, is by rolling out the lottery that you're seeing on screen right now. So, this is a Ludkin's article that goes on to elaborate a little bit on how to join the lottery and how the lottery is going to work. Basically, you enter the lottery and X amount of people who enter the lottery will win one of these boxes. They will obviously have to pay, but the main idea here is that you should be able to enter the lottery and, if you're lucky, win one of these. Obviously, you'll still have to pay for it, but it gives you an opportunity to own this item, and it is drawn by chance, not by some sort of convoluted, you know, robot reads HTML, and just because the robot's quicker than you are for mouse click for mouse click, that a scalper is able to get their hands on this product while you are not. Also, the lottery system helps because, in theory, scalpers probably aren't going to want to wait around that much because, you know, everything that they do is a game of hot potato. Sooner or later, they need to offload this product while it's hot, and after a while, this stuff is likely to cool down, and when that happens, they're not going to be able to turn as much of a profit. And that's why entering a lottery for a chance to win isn't as attractive an option for a particular scalper. However, I mention this article because of this paragraph right here. And as we can see right here, on the entry page, Pokemon Japan has stated that the 25th anniversary box will A, be a lottery, but then, here's the interesting part, will be available on a build-to-order status from spring 2022. That means if you're all, you know, if all goes according to plan, everyone who wants one should be able to purchase one. You'll simply request it be made for you, it will be created for you over the course of the rest of 2022, and then you're going to be able to get one of them later on. And this is a perfect option for someone who isn't interested in price volatility or the secondhand market price volatility. Instead, they're really just about collecting the item and perhaps not even wanting to open it. Well, for them, this build order status is perfect because you basically submit your ticket and then you wait to get your box in the mail. So it's actually a pretty good system. Now, how does it work? Well, it's exactly what it sounds like. Typically, build order systems can be found in a variety of different manufacturing industries. However, for the most part, this makes sense for such an interesting Pokemon item. Again, we know there's a lot of demand, and we know that demand can be hard to predict. On a business side, Pokemon has to constantly go up against the ebbs and flows of supply versus demand and how those two interact. Put it this way, if there's too much demand, you end up with product shortages. If there's too much supply because you overproduce to over exceed the demand in the market, then you end up with excess product. One way or the other, it always creates some sort of issue. And so, realistically, the perfect business that exists in a total vacuum would always produce just enough to meet demand. However, in an instance like this, one of the major things that has been impacting any company's ability to completely meet demand has been the global health pandemic. Because for a multitude of reasons, there are a bunch of different factors why companies cannot produce merchandise like the Pokemon box at the same rate they would in a pre-pandemic world. So, as a result, what ends up happening is Pokemon rolls out this pretty ingenious system. And I do have to say, this is a pretty smart way of going about it. Effectively, they set up a lottery for the short term. So in the short term, if you really want one of these boxes today, you have to realize that there is a shortage of labor, a shortage of materials, and a logistical nightmare from getting product from one part of the world to another. And so, you'll have to enter a lottery. It's luck of the draw, but in order to combat scalpers, we make it a convoluted system, and so, really, only the most motivated folks will likely enter. Don't get me wrong, tons of scalpers will probably enter this with the intention of winning it and flipping it anyway. However, the hope is that because there is a wait and because there is luck of the draw involved in this, there is a chance that more folks who genuinely want the box will get the box as a result of this Pokemon lottery. Then the second part of this is a build order, where everybody gets one, no matter how many you want. The only difference is the time frame is a lot longer, and because the time frame is a lot longer, mind you, this stuff is not slated for release until winter of 2022, which at this point is more than a full calendar year away, the benefit of that is that Pokemon now gets to take those numbers, calculate them, budget extremely well for time, for labor, for materials, and then go ahead and print the stuff off, perhaps over the summer, into early fall, get it shipped to where it needs to ship, and then have it ready to go for winter of 2022 when they're getting it to people who have pre-ordered this stuff. So, a build-to-order system in one or two sentences is really just tell me how much you want, I'll make it. You might have to wait a little bit longer, but the benefit is you'll get as many as you want. I have no problem making it. So that's what a build-to-order system is. And again, my second sort of big takeaway from this is that time is key. Time is a major factor in why they're able to do this, because again, more than a calendar year away means they have more than enough time to adequately budget all of the different resources that are necessary in order to produce this stuff and get it to the customers who want to participate in the build to order program. The thing is that time is also a factor for the average scalper. Bear in mind, earlier in this video, I said one of the most important things for a scalper is time, because they always play a game of hot potato. If they buy something that loses value overnight, they lose money. If they buy something that gains value overnight and they can sell it for a higher price, that is when a scalper effectively thrives. And that's what creates an environment where scalpers tend to propagate and really kind of multiply. Because if you can turn left and right and walk out Target and sell your stuff online for triple the price, it makes sense you would scalp, at least from a monetary perspective. So what is really cool about this is that it effectively takes away the ability for them to play a hot market, because one, everyone who wants one is going to be able to ask for one and receive it, and two, the added benefit is that it's going to take them a year to even get their hands on the stuff. And since everyone in the world who wants one can get one, there's a strong likelihood that scalpers won't want to play this game. Because again, a scalper can't plan for a year from now because you never know how price volatility is going to be. Many scalpers are scalpers primarily because demand is high right now and they need to take advantage of that right now in order to turn a quick buck. So time is a key consideration here, and it's one of the reasons why this is a great way to address the short-term issues with scalpers. Moving on to my third point, appreciation still occurs, and this is one thing that I have seen mistakenly interpreted across a couple different YouTube videos. Or because thumbnails can be a little misleading, or because titles can be a little misleading, or because people simply don't understand how things work. Here's the thing with a build-to-order status. The status, all it means is that you can ask for as many as you want, right? So in theory, I could ask for 1,000. I'm sure there's going to be a limit, but let's just pretend I could get 1,000, right? If I got 1,000 of these, right, and I kept them sealed for 20 years, would the price still remain the same? Probably not. Here's why. Any Pokemon product, we have to assume some percentage of it gets opened. So let's just say 1 million of these things get printed come winter 2022. Well, that's great and dandy. Let's just assume that 100,000 of them get opened up by, you know, the Leonhards of the world and, you know, folks without a YouTube channel. But hey, you know, they're hobbyists, right? They open the stuff because they want either the contents inside or because they want the commemorative Pokemon cards, etc., etc. So now there's only 900,000 of these left, right? Everyone who wanted one got one. And then let's just pretend that 20 years from now, the size of the hobby in terms of people has doubled. The problem is that the size of the hobby has continued to grow. And so not everyone who was around today is going to be around 20 years from now. And so there is a likelihood that there will still be more demand for this, at that point, vintage product than there was when this build-to-order system was implemented in the spring of 2022. And as a result, in the spring of 2042, it is very likely that as a result, the price of this will still be higher than RRP or MSRP. And the main reason for that is because there will inevitably be less of these available, and there will likely be more people, assuming constant growth in the Pokemon hobby, linear, non-linear, or other. And as a result of that, the growing number of people demanding this box will drive the prices up. Much like any vintage Pokemon card product, over time, and I realize this isn't vintage right now, but over time it will become so, when a vintage product sits for a period of time, it will appreciate. That's just the nature of the beast, because once this thing stops getting printed, right, and again, we understand that, hey, it will be build to order and technically they can print an infinite amount of these, but I guarantee you there will still be limitations to how much they can print. And that's not even from a COVID or health pandemic perspective, that's just more from a practicality standpoint. Like, you know, they can't print a billion of these things because I don't think there's enough of the stuff in the world to print that. You know what I mean? And as a result, what ends up happening is once this goes out of print, you will see price slowly begin to appreciate over the years. Because again, every year, less and less will exist because we have to assume 1, 2, 100, 200, 1,000 are going to get opened every single year. And simultaneously with that, more and more people who enter the hobby will stumble upon this product and end up wanting to have a sealed or opened one in their collection. And as a result, the combination decreases supply, increases demand, and forces price to meet at a higher equilibrium point. So, that's the key thing to understand about this. In summary, I think this new build-to-order system is a great way for Pokemon to combat scalpers. Again, the main takeaway is that time is a very key and essential element to understanding all of this. In the short term, scalpers thrive when they can flip product for more than MSRP. However, by creating a build-to-order system, Pokemon is going to better be able to budget all of the resources necessary to creating something like this, while at the same time deterring scalpers from entering something like this, because they know that for the most part, Scalpers aren't going to want to play a game of chance a year from now. They'd rather play the Evolving Skies flip game on Mercari today, and that's quite all right. However, it's going to dissuade scalpers from chasing after something that is going to be very sought after. The other key and critical component of this is that while we understand that the short term is to address the scalpers, bear in mind that vintage product likely will continue to appreciate in value. And so Pokemon's new build to order status, which I think we can reasonably expect to see for future product as well, will not necessarily guarantee that the price of modern Pokemon cards will continue at MSRP or near MSRP for the foreseeable future. Much like any vintage product that came before it from the WotC, Nintendo, or Pokemon Company eras, there is a very strong likelihood that as this stuff goes out of print and as the hobby continues to grow, decreasing supply and increasing demand will force a new equilibrium price point that will inevitably cause the appreciation that is so common in vintage Pokemon cards like we've seen over the past few years. But with all that said, friends, thanks again for checking out another video. I appreciate you stopping by, and like I said before, if you liked today's video, feel free to hit that like button, and hey, if you're not already, feel free to subscribe to the Gengar Gang to join the happy little community we have going on here. Other than that, friends, as always, I appreciate your viewership, and we will talk soon. Peace.